Welcome to another video. In this video, we're going to look at the grammar of Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21. And this is a continuation of a previous video that we did where we looked at the grammar of 5 verses 1 through 11. Normally we do these videos in chapter sections, but we decided to divide this one up mainly because verses 1 through 11 are so chock full of important grammatical highlights. So in this video, we'll take a look at 12 through 21. The video will be a little shorter because in this section, there's some really deep concepts here, kind of difficult to grasp, at least for me, but the grammar is pretty straightforward. And so let's begin by taking a look at here in verse 12, we have a preposition with a relative pronoun. And a lot of times these little expressions, these short little expressions with little words, sometimes there will be particles included or a relative pronoun or preposition. They're kind of hard to get at the meaning because they take on an idiomatic meaning. But if we look at the verse here, we can begin to understand contextually what he's saying. And when there's any doubt, we can always do a word search for that expression in the rest of the New Testament. And so he begins up here in verse 12 by saying, therefore, which of course this bears an important connection with what he said earlier. He's talking about the results of justification. And here he's going to review again how we got into this sinful mess in the first place. 12 through 21 is connected in an important way to what comes previously. And mainly here he's going to tell us why the nature of this justification is so surprising. It has some important parallels with how sin entered the world, but it also has some important contrasts with the nature of sin and resulting death. But he says, therefore, even as through one man sin into the world entered, and through sin death, and so upon all men death passed, or death came upon all men, efho all sinned. Now, the way I would translate this one, literally, it's in or upon that all sin, or we could say maybe in that all sin, and that would make sense in English. Probably a smoother expression would be in as much as all sinned. If there's any question with little constructions like this, you can always do a word search. Of course, I've got accordance open here, and I've already done a word search for epi there, and ho, I chose the inflected form of ho, a relative pronoun again, and then within, you can also choose within one word. So that means the whole follows the ep, as we see here for the first time in Acts 7, 33, a very literal meaning, and it sounds great as a translation in English, for the place upon which, that's a preposition upon, relative pronoun which, you stand is holy ground. That's pretty easy, pretty straightforward. Then we get to the writings of Paul. We see in 5:12, I said probably in that or in as much as all sinned, because he's explaining how this can be true. In 2 Corinthians 5:4, he says here, for those of us who are in the tabernacle or in our bodies still, we groan being burdened. Efho, we do not desire to be unclothed, but clothed in order that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Here too, I would say the hefho could be, or the efho could be translated as in as much as. That seems to make pretty good sense of the connection between what he says here and what follows. If we look again, for instance, at Philippians 3:12, not as though I already obtained or already have been perfected, but I am pursuing in order that I might reach it. He's talking about the goal of knowing Christ. And then he says, efho, again, really in as much as seems to make the most sense of this little expression used by Paul, in as much as, or even here to the extent that I also am reached or obtained in the sense that Christ has reached me in his salvation, that motivates the rest that I do for Christ, in as much as Christ has done this to me. And so here, again, whenever we see these little constructions, here we've got efho. We can do a word search, but looking at it contextually, keeping in mind the basic meanings of each word is a start. Then looking at it contextually, and if there's any question after that, because of course Paul builds his argument on a lot of times these little constructions here, we can do a word search for them, starting in Paul's writings to see if we can get at the exact meaning. Right here, I think in as much is a good translation. Let's take a look at verse 14. Verse 14 says, but the subject here is death, ha thanatos there. But death reigned from Adam until Moses, even upon those who did not sin. So we've got an article with the verbal form of amarteo, which is sin, of course. It's a participle form. We see the new tau there. We see the sigma alpha, so it's an aorist participle or undefined participle. Upon those who did not sin, after or in the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is the type or the figure of the one who was coming. He's talking in the past, so this is a continuous participle, but we're going to translate it with past time because the participle has relative time. So the one who was coming or who was about to come. In verse 14, there's a question that can be raised here. He says, and even upon those who did not sin in the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is the type or the figure of the one who is to come. So we could ask ourselves, well, what does it mean that there are some people who didn't sin after the likeness of the transgression of Adam? Haven't we all? Haven't we all inherited a sinful nature from Adam? And the answer is, yes, we have. But if we look earlier in verse 13 there, I think we'll find the clue for interpreting it, for understanding it. He says, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not reckoned where there is no law. And so when we come back down here to what he's explaining, that death reigned from Adam to Moses, even upon those who did not sin after the likeness of the transgression of Adam. What's different between Adam and all of his descendants up to the time of Moses is that Adam received specific command from God not to eat from the tree, and he did. Well, all of his descendants, they still didn't have the law as far as the specifics of what is sinful and what is not. And so they didn't sin in the likeness of the transgression of Adam in the sense that they didn't have that specific command of God. Now, how can we be sure about that? Well, if we look at verse 13, that's his point. And so he seems to be in 14b here elaborating on what he says in verse 13. Another interesting expression with which he ends verse 14 is, Adam is, who is, of course that's a relative pronoun, who is the type or the figure of the one who was coming. This is the word here, tupos, for type or kind. And of course, in the Bible, we have to grapple with typology. In other words, in the Old Testament, who serves as a type of Christ? Perhaps the most common that's used that isn't necessarily repeated in the New Testament is Joseph. Biblically, for instance, a type would be Melchizedek. He serves as a type of Christ. But here, the Apostle Paul is telling us that Adam is a type of Christ. And what he's going to proceed to tell us is that this means that there are some important parallels between Adam and Christ, but there's also some important contrasts. And in verse 15, he begins by talking about some of these parallels and some of these contrasts. The parallels are strong and the contrasts are even stronger. Let's take a look at verse 15, and then I want to review some of the key words that support what he introduces in verse 15. So he says, but not as is the transgression, the is I think is understood here, not as the transgression, so also is the gift. For if by or through one transgression many died, much more, palo malon, much more the grace of God and the gift in grace or by grace through one man, Jesus Christ, unto many abounded. Here with the 15, at the beginning of 15, he's going to introduce the contrast to us, right? But not as the transgression, everything that characterized the transgression, the transmission of sin, the effects of it. Grace is going to be rather different. That's what he's telling us here. What are some of the key words that we could emphasize as we're thinking through the significance of this text, maybe even preparing an outline ourselves or a lesson or a message? What are some of the key words that we could highlight? Well, first of all, here in verse 15, he says that the grace, which is through one man, Jesus Christ, unto many, abounded. Epirousesen is going to be one of his favorite words throughout this passage to try to express the abundant nature of the grace of God, because although there are some parallels, the contrasts are even more significant and more amazing. We also see it up here in verse 15 when he says, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace through one man, Jesus Christ. So much more, palo malon. We have epirousesen here. Down here in verse 17, we see palo malon again. And that's followed by periseon, which of course is the abundance of grace. And then down here in verse 20, just in case we miss the important contrasting nature of grace versus sin, he's going to say here, the law entered in order that the transgression might abound. And God allowed the law to be, he gave the law to highlight man's need of grace. That's clear because historically and spiritually, Israel, who had the law, failed to obey it, failed to keep it. And so Christ came to ensure that we live by the law and establish the law through the grace that was given to us through his life, his death, and his resurrection. But just in case we miss these important contrasts that are highlighted throughout this passage, he uses this word right here to describe grace. He says, but where sin abounded, he says, superabounded the grace, or grace superabounded. There we've got the preposition huper with the form of the word that we were just looking at, eperousesen, which is the idea of superabounded. These are some of the words in the context that show us the important contrast between the nature of sin and how it resulted in death, and the nature of grace and how it results in life, eternal life. But there's also some important parallels. So maybe a good way to approach this passage is to look at the parallels between sin and grace, but also to highlight the contrast between the nature of sin and the nature of grace. The idea here in verse 18 then is, therefore, as through one transgression, judgment unto all men, or judgment came upon all men. He says, and then we have the houtos here. So here this is establishing a parallel. So also through one righteous deed, we could even say the righteous life and death of Jesus Christ, through his righteousness unto all men, unto justification of life. So justification of life came unto all men. Here is the important connection. This is how Jesus is a type of Adam, that Adam was given the responsibility and the privilege of producing a whole race of people. Life came from Adam and Eve. So also, eternal life comes through Jesus Christ, and this is an important connection. This is how Jesus is a type. We've got hosper here. Again, this is a word that is kind of establishing a parallel here. For even as through the disobedience of one man, and so he's kind of repeating himself here. He says, for even as through the disobedience of one man, sinners they were constituted, the many. So the many, many were constituted sinners. Here we've got the houtos again. So also through the obedience of one, many were constituted or were made just. Let's take a look at verse 21, which kind of wraps up these important parallels and contrasts. He says in 21, in order that even as sin reigned unto death, sin results in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness unto eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.